Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Orange. I'm beginning to get the hint that it's not beginning to look like Christmas. It's beginning to look like vacation Bible school season. I like the fact that our church goes all out for VBS and sharing Christ's love with the kids of our church and our community, and that we do it right. And so this Sunday, we kind of have set the table, and hopefully you'll get excited about that. And if you haven't volunteered, you can be voluntold. I'm looking at Bethany. We could always use some more help around the edges, and appreciate all those of you that have stepped up and been making plans for all the different areas of responsibility, those of you that provide the funds. When you think about the fact every week that I invite you to join with us and share our tithes and our offerings, it's that weekly continuous contribution to the church's overall financial picture that allows us to have the budget to make this happen without a whole lot of begging and pleading that, oh, we need money for VBS, we got to buy it. We do this faithfully, and when we do that faithfully, then we have what we need to do the ministry. On the back of your bulletin are a number of announcements. Obviously, this week is VBS, as we said. There's a town hall meeting scheduled for June the 28th at 6:30 here in the sanctuary. This is a kind of an information meeting, not so much information about the conversation about disaffiliation per se, but this is about the process that we will go through with the Call Church Conference that is scheduled for July the 23rd, and you see that announcement there as well. But it is a good place. If you have additional questions, Brandon will find someone to answer them for you because he's done. No, it's a place to ask more questions for clarification. I'm a firm believer in information is important. And if you don't know, then ask. So this is another opportunity for that. This church is also good about doing our blood drives on a regular basis. And you see that we have one coming up on the 30th. Those of you that are part of that or have not been a part of that, please come and be a part of that and help us spread the word for that. And then you see the note there that June is just packed. Used to we had 3 months of summer and we could spread things out, VBS and this and that and the other, and it's down to supposedly 2 months, 8 weeks, but it's really compacted down to 6 weeks. And with VBS and everything we got going in June, I got a group together for a homecoming committee, and they've decided to shift homecoming until August. And so you see the information there. There have been some flyers in your bulletins, but we want to give homecoming space to be homecoming and not just another thing, or make you choose between whether you can be a part of homecoming or part of VBS or whatever. And so, we're rolling the dice and seeing if this is a good idea. The beautiful thing is, if we didn't like it this year, we can fix it next year. You can fix it next year. So please take note of that and help pass the word for those that are accustomed to it being in June, so they know that we haven't just done away with it. We've just tried to shift it to give it its own spot. That's all I got going on. Anybody got anything you need to add? Going once, going twice? Then Joy, come and lead us in singing.
Sorry. Good morning. With all of this wonderful stuff up here, we've kind of had to shift around. But, I was looking this week when I was selecting music, and his sermon topic is needed enthusiastic people. So that's us. So I have picked This Is the Day. I think we all know this song, and we can have some fun and get excited with it. So I invite you to please stand. If you need the words, it's page 657 in the Methodist hymnal. Let's all sing together. All right, Charles, go. Sing out.
This is the day, this is the day that the Lord hath made, that the Lord hath made. Let us rejoice, let us rejoice. Rejoice and be glad in it. This is the
we're going to play with it a little bit. This arm up, let's switch it. Women. Women are going to sing the first, "This Is the Day." And the guys with this hand up, you're doing the repeat. And if both hands are up, we're all going to sing. Let's see how we do. Let's go, Charles. Ready, ladies? This is the day. Guys. This is the day that the Lord hath. Come on, guys. This is the day that the Lord hath made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Ladies, this is the day. Guys, this is the day that the Lord hath made. Great job. Thank you. Please be seated.
So instead of it just being the Sunday before we begin Vacation Bible School, today is Father's Day, a day where we recognize the role that fathers play in the life of our families, the life of our community, the life of our church. And so I want to invite all the men folk to please stand, because as women, you don't have to have birthed a child to have fathered children. So will you stand, gentlemen? Ladies, will you help me thank them? Stay standing, because we got something for you. If you stay standing, I got some oranges I'll throw at you. No. We have some folks going to run some oranges around for you. Once you get your orange, you'll be seated. That way they'll know who needs one. And I'm sorry, these are the biggest ones they could find. Forget the guys back at the booth. And don't forget Charles over here. I got everybody? We are thankful for the men in our lives, and I saw a short piece of a TED Talk the other night. I've seen it before, but a lady was giving some statistics, and having a father in the home is one of the most defining characteristics of children growing up successful in life, and that's not dinging women. It's showing how important it is for young people to have male role models in their lives. And so dads and guys and those of you younger folks, understand the importance of that. And the world is trying to teach us that what we grew up with as the nuclear family, mom, dad, and the kids, isn't necessary. But what we're finding is it is very necessary for a successful society. And so just as important as it is for us to support women in their mothering role, it's important to support men in their fathering role. And I know that's a little old-fashioned, but there are things that we can do as men and women that the other can substitute for but can't do as well. And so we want to be sure that we do what we can do. I was mother and father for a short period of time. I'm really glad I'm not a mama. That's a tough job. Let's remember our roles and take those on and support those that are part of that. And so this morning, as we come to a time of prayer, let's give thanks for those parental figures in our lives. Will you join with me as we pray? You are our God. may you be gracious to us. Many of us are thrown out of our families because parents fuss over privilege. Like Hagar's son, we wander in the wilderness of desertion without a home. Our fathers are gone. Oh God, be a parent to us. Shelter us from pangs of poverty and the insecurity of an uncertain future. Preserve our lives, O God, for to you we cry all day long. Give us a hearing, O precious Savior, in our day of trouble. We need you every hour to assure us that we will not be abandoned to the night. Teach us your ways, O God, that we may walk in your truth. Give each one of us an undivided heart so that we can honor your name. Receive our acts of devotion as feeble but honest efforts to revere the one who honors our efforts to persevere. Deliver us, O God, from the war zone of domestic battles. We've struggled with our fathers. We've battled with our mothers. Our enemies feel like members of our own household. Each day is a struggle with an accusing other. Aid us, O God, to find a way out of this turmoil. Grant each of us the capacity to surrender our self-righteousness on the altar of your purpose for us. Save us from the mean spirit of self-pity. Enliven us to a living hope of those who find their lives by losing them in your service. We turn to you, O gracious one. Give strength to your servants and save the lives of your parentless children. Show them a sign of your comfort and favor. Incline your ear toward them, O God, and answer them for the sake of the child of God who had no place to rest. May you hear this, our prayer, prayed in the name of your Son, who taught us how to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Truly blessed here at Orange to have so many father and father figures that are strong men of faith. So in honor of all of them, I invite you to please stand and join me. Page 710, Faith of Our Fathers. We'll sing all three verses.
Oh, how our hearts beat high with joy.
Please be seated.
Will you join with me as we share our morning tithes and offerings as our ushers come forward? Gracious God, we thank you for this day and the chance to continue participating in the financial support of this church and its mission and ministry to our community. As we see the fruits of that, as we reach out through the model of Vacation Bible School, we thank you for the faithfulness of those who not only teach and serve and lead, but those who provided the financial resources to acquire the materials as we seek to share Jesus in our community. May we continue to be generous and faithful, and these are gifts to the glory of your Son, Jesus. Amen.
Hope this goes over well. I woke up congested and all kinds of fun stuff, so pray for me.
Daddy's hands, soft and kind when I was crying, Daddy's.
little, but I've come to understand there was always love in Daddy's hands. Daddy's hands, soft and kind when I was crying. Daddy's hands were hard as steel when I'd done wrong. Daddy's hands weren't always gentle, but I've come to understand there was always love in Daddy's hands.
Thank you for that, Sue. I think that the first Sunday I preached, you sang the special, Good, Good Father for Me. I think that was the very first sermon. It's amazing how things come around full circle, because next Sunday will be my last Sunday here, and we will be worshiping with the young people from our Vacation Bible School who will be sharing their faith with us, which is how I spent my very first Sunday with you, was on Vacation Bible School Sunday as the kids shared their faith. And so we'll have come full circle in 4 years together. Hopefully one of the things you have learned about me is that when we come to worship, we come to worship. We don't come to talk about denominational issues. We don't come to talk about societal things. We don't come to talk about politics. We come to worship Almighty God, and we come to look at the Holy Scriptures and see how they apply to our lives and how we need to live our lives. And that's how we're going to end together, because I hope I'm leaving an enthusiastic group of people for Greg to come in and pick up and carry this thing forward as we do in a relay race. I have run my time, and I'm being asked to go now and run a leg with another group of believers in Christ, and you are being asked to participate with another pastor. And we all bring things to the table. And so our scripture this morning is out of Matthew's Gospel, the 10th chapter. We're going to start reading in the 26th verse. I'm reading again from the Common English Translation. Therefore, don't be afraid of those people, because nothing is hidden that won't be revealed, and nothing secret that won't be brought out into the open. What I say to you in the darkness, tell in the light, and what you hear whispered, announce from the rooftops. Don't be afraid of those who kill the body but can't kill the soul. Instead, be afraid of the one who can destroy both body and soul in hell. Aren't two sparrows sold for a small coin? But not one of them will fall to the ground without your Father knowing about it already. Even the hairs of your head are all counted. Don't be afraid. You are worth more than many sparrows. Therefore, anyone who acknowledges me before people, I will also acknowledge before my Father who is in heaven. But everyone who denies me before people, I also will deny before my Father who is in heaven. May God add his blessing to the reading and the hearing of his holy word. I saw a Facebook post basically along the same lines of the story I'm about to tell you. It was about an agency, a spy agency, seeking to find replacement spies to fill empty positions. The story I'm sharing with you is told about the CIA, the Central Intelligence Agency here in the U.S. They were in need of a new spy. I don't know why. Maybe they got killed or whatever. And so these highly classified positions, as you can imagine, are hard to fill. You don't want just anybody in these roles. There's a lot of testing that goes on, a lot of deep background checks that are involved before you can even be considered serving in the CIA. So after sending some of these applicants through all the background checks and the training and the testing and all the stuff, they narrowed down the possibility to three people, two men and one woman. But there was only one position they were seeking to fill, so the day came for the final test to see which of these three individuals would get this highly secretive job. Now, the CIA people administering the test took one of the men to a large metal door, handed him a handgun, and said, "Now, we've got to know that you will follow our instructions, no matter what they are, to the letter. You've got to do exactly what we tell you, no matter what we tell you. So inside this room, your wife is tied to a chair. Take this gun, go in that room, and kill her." The man got a shocked look on his face, and he said, you can't be serious. I could never shoot my own wife." Well, the test instructor said, "Then obviously you're not the right person for this job. You're dismissed." So they bring the second man in front of the same metal door, and they hand him the gun, and they tell him the same thing that they told the first guy, that his wife was tied to a chair, he was to enter the room and to kill his wife. The man looked shocked, but he took the gun and he opened the door and entered the room and closed the door. All was deathly quiet in the room for about 5 minutes. Then the door opened and the man steps out of the room with tears in his eyes. He said, I tried to shoot her. I just couldn't pull the trigger and kill my own wife. I guess I'm not the right man for this job." "No," the CIA told him, "you don't have what it takes. Take your wife and go home." They turn to the lone woman that had qualified for this test, and they bring her to the same door of the same room and hand her the same gun. And they tell her, "We are sure that you will follow the instructions no matter the circumstances. This is your final test. Inside, you will find your husband tied to a chair. Take this gun and kill him." The woman takes the gun, she opens the door, closes it behind her, and before the door even gets closed good, the CIA man outside the door hears the gun firing, one shot after another, bang, 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 13 shots are fired. And then pandemonium breaks out in the room, and they hear screaming and crashing and banging against the walls, and it went on for several minutes. And then all was deathly quiet. The door slowly opens, and there stands the woman, disheveled, covered in sweat. She wipes the sweat from her brow and says, "Now, you guys didn't tell me that gun was loaded with blanks. I had to beat him to death with a chair." This is Father's Day. And fathers and men in general have taken quite a beating lately, haven't they? But today I want to recognize the men who have taken their responsibility for their families just as seriously as they have taken their responsibilities to God. And many of you in the role of father have done just that. Not only to children that you are the biological parent of, but those you have adopted, those you have step-parented, those that you have stepped up into leadership roles in various institutions and organizations through the church, through things like scouting and things we do in the schools. And so today we want to say thank you. In the same vein of the other day, I shared a couple of top 10 lists from David Letterman. I want to share another top 10 list with you today. These are the top 10 things you'll probably never hear a dad say. Number 10. "Well, how about that? I'm lost. Guess we'll pull over and ask for some directions." Number 9. "Well, you know, Pumpkin, now that you're 13, you're ready for unchaperoned car dates. Won't that be fun?" Number 8, "I notice all your friends have a certain in-your-face attitude. You know, I kind of like that." Number 7, "Oh, here's a credit card and keys to the new car. Go have fun." Number 6, "What do you mean you want to play football? Figure skating not good enough for you, son?" That's a little sexist, but... Number five, your mother and I are going to go away for the weekend. Might be a good time to have a party. Number four, well, I don't know what's wrong with your car. Probably one of those doohickey thingamabobs that makes it run or something. Just have it towed to the mechanic and pay them whatever they ask. Number three, no son of mine is going to live under this roof without an ear piercing. Now, quit your belly aching. Let's go to the mall. Number two, what do you want to go and get a job for? I make plenty of money. And the number one thing you probably will never hear a dad say on Father's Day? Father's Day? Don't worry about it. It's no big deal. Our gospel lesson this morning is one that I think most dads will like, where Jesus says to his disciples, what I tell you in the dark, speak in the daylight. What is whispered in your ear, proclaim from the roofs. What Jesus is talking about, I believe, is about being enthusiastic about your faith. Now, most of the houses in Jesus' time had a flat roof. It was an architectural thing. Now, if you've noticed, the architectural thing is really common around here nowadays. All the new houses are white with black trim. Have you noticed that? All the new houses are white with black trim. I kind of liked it for the first 100 or so houses I saw painted like that. But most of the time, Jesus' houses had flat roofs. It was a construction technique that worked in that part of the world. And people would use that flat roof area as a place to sit in the evenings. They would use it to dry straw. They would use it to work, to find a time to relax up there. And when people had really important news to proclaim, they would often shout it from their rooftops. You know, we try to get up when we have something to announce, and it was an easy thing to go to the rooftop. And Jesus is talking about having the same kind of openness about your religious convictions as you do for your favorite sports team. You've heard me say it before. If we could have just half the amount of investment in our faith that we have in our sports teams, with all the stuff we buy to decorate our cars and our houses and the uniforms and the jerseys and the time we spend with subscription services to watch it on TV, what we pay to go to the game and the concessions that we buy, and the amount of energy and effort and excitement that we pour into our sports and athletic teams, if we could put just a piece of that into the church, think what would have happened. And I'm not saying take it away from that. We just put some more over here. It'd be an amazing transformation in our world. What I tell you in the dark, speak in the daylight. What is whispered in your ear, proclaim it from the rooftops. What Jesus is looking for is enthusiastic people. Jesus is looking for people who have a positive feeling about their faith and are willing to take positive actions to affect the world. Why do these big box contemporary churches grow so fast? Because the people that are a part of them are enthusiastic about what's going on in their church, and they just talk to people about it, and they talk about it. They're excited about it. They invite people over and over and over to become a part of it. It's not because the preacher's that good. I've listened. They're good. They're not that good. It's the enthusiasm of the people in the pews about the mission and ministry that's happening there. Jesus wants enthusiastic people. Jesus is looking for people with a positive feeling about their faith who are willing to take positive actions in an effort to affect the world. There's, you know, sports brings a lot of interesting illustrations to our faith. Even though I'm not a huge sports fan, there's a lot to be learned from things that happen around sports. Some time back, the Washington Redskins quarterback at the time, Gus Ferrero, F-R-E-R-O-T-T-E, Gus, he was a Washington Redskins. You know, I can't get folks with names like Smith and Jones to tell. You have to have a weird name to be a good illustration. Anyway, he was taken to the hospital with a self-inflicted neck injury. In his exuberance after scoring a touchdown on the one-yard scramble against a game with the New York Giants, Gus headbutted the padded concrete wall surrounding the playing field. You know how players do. X-rays were negative, but they took him to Prince George's County Hospital as a precautionary effort. They found out he had sprained his neck in the act. Now, I've watched other videos. I like highlights. You know, they boil the game down to the six or eight exciting things that happened during the game. There was one player celebrating, and he jumped up in celebration. When he came down, he hit the ground like a sack of wet cement. He pulled something really major in his leg. He was out of the game for the rest of the game and most of the season, just celebrating. You know, it's fun to watch athletes get excited about what they're doing, isn't it? It's really fun. It's why we like watching our kids play ball and doing things. But sometimes you wonder if some of them are more prone to injuring themselves in their celebrations than they are from the game itself. Have you seen that? You with me? Hello? I much prefer their attitude, though, to that of what I've read about Colin Montgomery. Reese, you know Colin Montgomery, famous golfer. If you don't, look him up. He's really good. At the U.S. Open near Detroit some years back, Montgomery cursed at a spectator who was trying to encourage him. "There's too much bloody cheering in this country," he said. "I want you to play like him. I want you to be an entirely different person." At the Irish Open, when Montgomery was leaning over to mark his ball on the green, a teenager took a picture. Montgomery said, "Put that thing away or I'll wrap it around you." Well, I'm not going to repeat what the rest he said. But he's not a person that appears to have an enthusiastic approach to his work. Having said that, though, I must add that the worst attitude of all is shared by those who don't ever get excited about anything, even things they dislike. The worst approach to life is shared by those who do nothing but observe and criticize others. And yes, I see it a lot within the life of a church. There are a group of folks that like to sit back and just nitpick everything that's happening, but they're not ever willing to be a part of what's going on. They just lob those little grenades out there. And they're in the schools. And those of you who have kids in athletics, they're there too. They're not there for the practices or the what, but they have lots to say about how things are being run. They're in every organization. According to a research commissioned by the Weather Channel, 1 in 5 viewers of the Weather Channel watches at least 3 hours at a sitting. The company calls these people weather involved. Can you imagine that? I mean, if you watch the Weather Channel 3 hours a day, I would say you need to get a life. But 3 hours at a sitting? Oh, my word. Again, let me say, Jesus is looking for enthusiastic people. You see, the most significant thing that many of us could do to increase the effectiveness of both our own witness for Christ and our personal success would be to develop an enthusiastic attitude. Psychologist William James said, "It is our attitude at the beginning of a difficult undertaking which more than anything else will determine its successful outcome." Dr. Judith Briles is an effective speaker and writer, wrote a book called The Confidence Factor. In it, she lists what she calls the 10 commandments of confidence, and I've prepared a handout for you so you can take these home. So that's what that insert is. She calls them the 10 commandments of confidence. And these are written for business people, but I believe they could be important for all of us. Because how we feel about ourselves will greatly affect our enthusiasm for the work of God. So let me walk you through these, the 10 commandments. Number one, to your own self be true. Listen to your inner voice. Don't let others derail you. March to your own tune, not to someone else's. Number two, create positive thinking. Associate with energy chargers. Don't let negativism drag you down. You ever been like that? Been around folks and they just suck the life out of you. They're so negative. Number three, know that you are not alone. Remember, millions of people have walked in the footsteps before you and millions will walk in those footsteps after you. Whatever you're going through, others have gone through. Learn something new. Get busy, sign up for classes, read a book, get involved in the community. Whatever you do, it will rejuvenate your brain cells. Number five, assess the situation. Be realistic. What would really happen if you lost your job or lost a bid on a contract or if the business really got bleak? And you can tie this with the next one. Take credit for your accomplishments. Pat yourself on the back. Keep a file containing all the complimentary things others have said about you and your work. Review it when things look bleak. In a time of crisis, it's good to have such positive input at hand. Let me tell you, the notes that you gave me last on the 4th, I have a file folder in my file cabinet called Attaboy. Because when I was first in business, they talked about keeping an Attaboy file. I've got an Attaboy file. And in it, I put notes from people who have said nice things to me about things that we've done together. Some of them, many of them, are notes of appreciation following walking through a death with a family or a serious illness or celebrating a wedding. But some of them are just notes, just want to let you know, hey, you know, I appreciate what you're doing. Some of them are even notes of, you know, that didn't really go well, but thanks for trying. You know, it's one of those, you know, they're not all 100% positive, but when things get tough or I begin to question why I even get up in the morning, I can go pull that file out and find out that at certain points across my ministry, it has mattered that I do what I do. And that's not to inflate my ego, but it's just to remind me, because very often you can get at a place where you don't wonder, why am I even doing this? And so I suggest you create one of those. And have that around. Number seven, aspire higher. Stretch yourself. Consider your role models both in and out of your field of work. And you should have role models not only in what it is you do, but from outside of that. Folks that you achieve to be like. Read about them. Strive to be like them. Number eight, don't bottle things up. Get some feedback. This is a scary one because don't ask a question if you don't want to get an answer. Sometimes the answer isn't what you want to hear, but I would rather hear what I don't want to hear so I know what is than to not know what's going on so that I continue to do things that are not positive. Don't bottle things up. Talk with those that you can trust. Make sure the feedback you get is from someone who is caring, supportive, and non-judgmental, but who will tell you the truth. Number nine, take care of yourself. This is one that we have a real problem with in society for a lot of us. Eat right. Exercise. Sleep. Play. Laugh a lot. Get your life in balance. Learn to make time for yourself. And number 10, keep in circulation. When rough times or failures hit, it's common to withdraw. To not let the outside world know that all's not well. The sooner you re-involve yourself, the sooner you get back on target. It's called get back on the horse when you've been thrown off. Jesus wants enthusiastic followers. He wants people who have a healthy appreciation of themselves and of others. He wants people who are excited and involved in their church and in their community. And of course, the primary source of this enthusiasm will be Christ himself. Enthusiasm comes from the Greek words that mean the God within. And the surest path to a positive, active, enthusiastic life is to open ourselves to the work of Christ's indwelling spirit. Gordon MacDonald wrote a book called The Life God Blesses. And in it, he tells a story about a Chinese pastor who spoke at a conference in England. This pastor has spent 18 years in prison for his faith. He recalled for the audience his prison experience, his testimony. And I want to share that with you in his words as they were recorded. My friends wonder what kind of work I did in the labor camp to keep me physically healthy. I answered them that life in the labor camp was very, very hard. The authorities in the camp put me to emptying the human waste cesspool. Most of the prisoners were afraid to even approach the cesspool. But the authorities were aware of my background. I was well-educated. I was from a well-to-do family. And especially because they were atheists and they knew that I was a Christian leader. So they enjoyed putting me to work in the human waste cesspool. But they did not know in those years how I enjoyed working there. It was more than 2 meters in breadth and 2 meters in length. Now, I'm not a metric guy, but I think a meter is 39 inches, so it's a little over 6 feet in each direction. And it was filled with human waste collected from the entire camp. Once it was full, the human waste was kept until it was ripe, and then it was dug out and sent to the fields as fertilizer. Because the pit was so deep, I could not reach the bottom to empty it. So I had to walk into the disease-ridden mass and scoop out the successive layers of human waste, all the time breathing the strong stench. The guards and all the prisoners kept a long way off because of the stench. So why did I enjoy working in the cesspool? I enjoyed the solitude. In the labor camp, all the prisoners normally were under strict surveillance and no one could be alone. But when I worked in the cesspool, I could be alone and I could pray to our Lord as loudly as I needed. I could recite the scriptures, including all the psalms I still remembered, and no one was close enough to protest. That's the reason I enjoyed working in the cesspool. Also, I could sing loudly the hymns I still remembered. In those days, one of my favorite was In the Garden. Before I was arrested, this was my favorite hymn, but at that time I did not realize the real meaning of this hymn. When I worked in the cesspool, I knew and I discovered a wonderful fellowship with our Lord. Again and again I sang this hymn and I felt our Lord's presence with me. I come to the garden alone while the dew is still on the roses. And the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses. And he walks with me. And he talks with me. And he tells me I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. Again and again, as I sang this hymn in the cesspool, I experienced the Lord's presence. He never left me or forsook me. And so I survived, and the cesspool became my private garden. Now, that's not a very pleasant story, is it? But it is a powerful story about a man who let his faith in Christ rather than his circumstances determine his attitude. Jesus wants enthusiastic, excited followers. Jesus wants people who will serve him in the world with a positive and expectant spirit. And if need be, he wants people who can sing his praises in a cesspool. Such an enthusiastic spirit begins when we allow Christ's spirit to invade our lives. Jesus needs enthusiastic people. How about it? Let's pray. Gracious God, it's easy to let the world get us down, to shut us down, to make us withdraw. May your Holy Spirit infill us so that we can experience the enthusiasm that comes from knowing you and knowing that you have need of us to share your love with those around us. May we be enthusiastic about sharing our faith. And may others catch that spirit of enthusiasm and bring it into their lives. And together may we be lifted up and experience your presence in a new and exciting way. Even if we're standing in a cesspool. To the glory of your Son Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Since this is your last sermon here at Orange, I thought a perfect send-off song would be page 672, God Be With You Till We Meet Again. Please stand and join me on the first and last verses.
God be with you till we meet again.
There's a lot of enthusiasm in the church right now with VBS coming. A lot of excitement, a lot of anticipation, a lot of preparation. And you know what? That should happen every single week. We should be enthusiastic. We should be preparing. We should be excited about what might be coming. Because God always has something new for us. May you be enthusiastic, even if you are called to praise God in the middle of a cesspool. To God's glory, may you be enthusiastic. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, go in peace. Amen.